Welcome, my friend. Hey, hey, you. Shut up. You may have that sexy British accent, but I want my turn here, so shove off. Welcome, my friends, to an adventure like no other. There's space, starships, mice, aliens, time travel, explosions, the ultimate question and the ultimate answer, and robots. It's got everything you could ever want out of a 6-episode BBC miniseries. That's right, it's... Well, I mean, you saw the title of the video, so... This story of ours begins with the end of the world, which just so happens to be on a beautiful Thursday morning. This is Arthur Dent, and the reason he's laying on the ground is because his house is about to be demolished, and he isn't too keen on letting that happen. While laying, Arthur's friend Ford Prefect comes over. After a little negotiating, Ford convinces Arthur to go get a drink with him at the local pub, and once they're there, Ford lets Arthur in on a neat little tidbit of info.
Drink up. The world's about to end.
Oh, and that Ford is also an alien. Dismissing what he just heard as some crazy talk, Arthur, worried for his home, leaves in a hurry. Ford chases after him, but not before grabbing some peanuts. The Vogon arrive, declaring their intentions to demolish Earth, while Ford catches up with Arthur and convinces him to get beamed up onto a Vogon ship above them. Now aboard the ship, Ford tries to explain the situation to a very confused Arthur. But he shows very little sympathy towards Arthur's predicament.
Listen, I'm a bit upset about that.
Oh, well.
Oh, and he also puts a fish in his ear. Our heroes get caught by a guard and are taken to the captain, where they are subjected to be forced to listen to some of his poetry.
The jerking, slated agro-crustules.
How very unfortunate for them. Afterwards, the two are thrown out into space. Through the use of a little device called the Infinite Improbability Drive, a starship called Heart of Gold conveniently picks Arthur and Ford up 1 second before they would have died. The Heart of Gold was stolen by the two-headed Zaphod Beeblebrox, who invented the Pangalactic Gargle Blaster and just so happens to be a semi-cousin of Ford. Accompanying Zaphod in the starship is Earthwoman Trillian. These two met on Earth in London 6 months prior at a party. A party that Arthur just so happens to have gone to as well. In fact, Arthur was trying to sweet-talk Trillian when Zaphod swooped in and took her away. Also aboard the Heart of Gold is Marvin, a very depressed robot that nobody really likes all that much, but tolerates nonetheless.
Life, don't talk to me about life.
With these new companions, the crew makes its way on over to a mysterious planet that most of the universe doesn't believe exists, called Magrathea. When they start getting close to the planet, its automatic defense systems kick in and fire 2 nuclear missiles. All attempts to evade these missiles fall short, though. It looks like this is it for our heroes. How even more very unfortunate for them. Too bad there isn't a device of some kind they could use to conveniently get them out of this pickle they're in. Unfortunately, actions do have consequences, and by using the Infinite Improbability Drive, one of the missiles was turned into a whale, which gets pulled down by Magrathea's gravity, and, well, I'm sure you can figure out what happens next. Now out of harm's way, the crew lands on the planet and goes out to explore. Now that I think about it, I should probably explain why they even came here in the first place. I don't really feel like it. But something that I do feel like telling you is that underneath this planet is a gateway to another place where a bunch of people used to design and build planets for rich people. One planet that was made down here just so happens to have been Earth, and believe it or not, Earth was actually commissioned to be built by a couple of mice. But I'm getting a little ahead of myself here. The gang wanders around until they find a tunnel. Most go in, but not all of them. For safety reasons, according to Zaphod. Ford, Trillian, and Zaphod walk down this tunnel until they find a bright light. Meanwhile, Arthur chills with Marvin until an old guy approaches them. His name is Slaughterbartfast. I don't really want to explain what his whole deal is, so I'll just let him do it.
No disrespect, but I gathered you were all dead.
Dead? No, we haven't slept for 5 million years. Is that your robot? Bring it.
Bring it. Bring it.
On second thought, leave it here.
We are going deep into the bowels of the planet.
Hold tight! Welcome to our factory floor.
the Earth.
Well, the Earth Mark II, in fact. We're making a copy from our original blueprints. Did you ever go to a place, I think it was called Norway?
No, I didn't.
Pity. That was one of mine.
Now, before I go any further, I feel a little obligated to give a sort of history lesson here, for context reasons, of course. Now, all this stuff should be common knowledge already, so I'm going to go through it a little quickly. Please try to keep up. Millions of years ago, there was a race of hyper-intelligent, pan-dimensional beings that wanted to find out once and for all what the true meaning of life, the universe, and everything was. So they built a supercomputer called Deep Thought to figure it out for them. And so Deep Thought thinks it over for a little, and comes up with the answer 42. Confused and unsatisfied, the pan-dimensional beings demand an explanation, which Deep Thought responds to with,
"You have to know what the question actually is, in order to know what the answer means."
Now, unfortunately, this was too tricky of a question for Deep Thought to figure out, so it instead designed a superior computer that would be able to solve this problem instead. And this new computer program was called the Earth. And the mice I mentioned before are the transformed pan-dimensional beings who were sent to navigate this program. Unfortunately, it would take 10 million years for the Earth to complete its program and come up with an answer, so there was going to be a little more waiting. What's even more unfortunate is that it was only 5 minutes away from completing its program when it was destroyed by the Vogons. Alright, now back to Arthur. He is brought to a dining room by Slaughterbart Fest where the rest of our gang are munching away. In this room, our heroes have a little chat with two mice named Benji Mouse and Frankie Mouse. With Arthur being the last human ever to be on Earth, the mice believe that somewhere in his brain may lie the question to the answer 42 they've been waiting 10 million years to find out. But Arthur doesn't really want to give up his brain. Before anything else can happen though, the Galactic Police arrive because of, well, you know, Zaphod's crimes, forcing the gang to book it and leave the mice. Not knowing where to go, they just end up running into the cops anyways.
"It isn't easy being a cop."
"What did he say?"
"He said it isn't easy being a cop."
"Well, that's his problem, isn't it?"
"I thought so, yeah."
Cornered by the two Galactic Police officers, the computer bank that the gang is using for cover suddenly heats up and explodes. The next thing they know, they're waking up at a fancy-looking restaurant, presuming it to be the afterlife. It's not. This fine establishment is Milliways, the restaurant at the end of the universe, a place where people travel through time to eat a lavish meal while they watch the beauty and wonder of the universe coming to its end. While the gang is having a good time ordering food and whatnot, Zaphod gets a call from someone we may have all forgotten about.
"I think you ought to know I'm feeling very depressed."
The thing about Milliways is that it was built on the remains of Magrathea, which explains why Marvin is here. He's been waiting quite a while for everyone else to show back up. 576,000 million years to be exact. But anyways, Zaphod and Ford find a ship so black you can barely see it because it absorbs so much light. And given Zaphod's history with ships, you can probably guess what he wants to do.
"Do you think we should?"
"No.
Neither do I. Let's do it."
"Okay."
Once in the ship, its autopilot gets activated and is sent back through time from whence it came. Now, it just so happens that our friends here unknowingly decided to steal a ship that belonged to the plutonium rock band Disaster Area. And so it's quite unfortunate to find out that this ship would be used for one of the things that Disaster Area is known for doing during a performance.
"The ship is going to dive into the sun."
Unable to turn off the autopilot, our heroes head closer and closer towards their fiery demise. That is, until they find a teleporter that they can use to get themselves out of there. Unfortunately, this device requires someone to manually activate it, so somebody's gonna have to stay back and sacrifice themselves to save the rest of the group.
"Hey, Marvin kid! How you doing?"
"Very badly, I suspect."
And so Marvin, having saved everyone's lives, dives right into that flaming ball of fire, still complaining all the while. Arthur and Ford are teleported onto a giant spaceship where most of its crew is strangely frozen. Zaphod and Trillian aren't here, though. They must have gotten teleported off somewhere else. Oh well. So the people on this ship come from the planet Golgafrinchim. And the thing about all these folks on this ship is that they're all more of the average, boring, and useless people from their planet. Everyone else on Golgafrinchim wanted these fools gone, so they tricked them into leaving on a giant ship, making them believe that their planet was doomed so they would have to go and find a new one to colonize. Oh, and their ship was also programmed to crash onto the new planet they were going to. After crash landing on this prehistoric planet, Ford and Arthur find this new place to be a little odd, so they decide to go traveling. A year and a bit later, they come back with some new information. However, the Golgafrenchims don't seem to care too much about what they found, probably because they're a bunch of useless morons. But maybe you'll find it a little more interesting instead. During their year-long journey, Ford and Arthur traveled and found Slaughterbartfest's signature in Norway, so that means this planet is Earth 2 million years before it gets destroyed. It's too bad these idiots don't care about this kind of thing. Oh well. What else can you do really besides try to teach some cavemen how to play Scrabble? Probably won't work out though. Oh, I almost forgot. Remember 42? Well, Arthur and Ford think of a way of using Arthur's brainwaves and their Scrabble board to figure out what that ultimate question is that those mice wanted to know so badly.
What do you get if you multiply 6 by N-I-N-E. 9! 6 by 9. I always said there was something fundamentally wrong with the universe.
Huh. Well, you live and learn, I guess. You live and learn.
Yes, I think to myself, what a wonder.